All right, everyone, let's go ahead and get started. Is there anyone that is having difficulty getting into the Zoom meeting? Does anyone know if anyone's having difficulty? There shouldn't be a waiting room available anymore. Okay, let's go ahead and get started. So again, my name's Noreen, and we will be talking about the MCAT today and how to prepare for it. This workshop is sponsored by the American Muslim Women Physicians Association, AMWPA. So what exactly is AMWPA? It's an organization that is committed to improving the condition of women's health, providing a platform for Muslim women in medicine, and raising awareness of issues regarding community welfare and preventative healthcare is our passion. AMWPA is also a nonprofit 501c corporation, and it was founded in 2008. So before we begin, we all, as a Muslim organization, we will be beginning with some Quran. And so because we're talking about the MCAT, going to medical school, and starting your process as a lifelong learner, we decided to quote some ayat from the Quran. This is specifically Surah Al-Alaq, starting with بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. So what does this mean? It means read in the name of your Lord who created. He created man from a clinging form. Read, your Lord is the most bountiful one who taught by means of the pen, who taught man what he did not know. So keeping that in mind, you know, that learning is part of Islam. And so we hope that you will keep that in your back of your mind. And let's go ahead and get started. So like I introduced, my name is Noreen. I am an MS1 at UT Southwestern in Dallas. I did my undergrad at UT Dallas and I majored in neuroscience. Next up, we have our panelist Afifa.
Welcome, everyone. My name's Afifa. I am also a first-year medical student at UT Southwestern in Dallas. For undergrad, I studied biological engineering at MIT. Over to Amina.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. My name is Amna Assam, and I'm an MS1 at McGovern Medical School down in Houston. I also went to UT Dallas for undergrad, and I majored in biochemistry.
Assalamu alaikum, everybody. My name is Salman. I am an MS2 at UT Southwestern, and I also went to UT Dallas and studied biology.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. My name is Mahnoor. I'm an MS2, technically OS2 at TCOM, and I studied psychology at university.
All right. And so just for logistical purposes, if you have any questions, feel free to put them in the chat and I will be happy to answer them. If you have a specific question for one of the panelists, you are certainly welcome to DM them or you can ask me in the chat and I can ask them the question on the over the phone call. And then if you have any general questions or things that weren't answered in the slideshow, there is a section for Q&A at the end. All right, let's go ahead and get started.
Okay, so I'm going to begin by starting about the MCAT. So exactly what is the MCAT? It stands for the Medical College Admissions Test, and this is basically the entrance exam that's required for the majority of medical school programs throughout the United States. It's a multiple choice exam with each question having four different answer choices. It's a long exam, 6 hours and 15 minutes, and it is managed by the AAMC. So on the MCAT, there are a total of 230 questions split into four sections. So those four sections include the chemistry and physics section, the CARS section, which is the critical analysis and reading section, followed by B&B, which is biology and biochem, and the psychology and sociology section. In each section, there's about 53 to 59 questions, and you get about 90 to 95 minutes per section. Depending on how many questions there are as well. So the MCAT itself is scored on a range from 472 being the lowest score you can get and 528 being the highest score. Each section is scored individually. So each section you can get between 118 to 132. The mean and median overall score is 500. The way that the MCAT is scored is you only get points for correct answers. So if you get if you select the wrong answer, you do not get a penalty. It's weighted the same as if you didn't answer that question at all. The score will be scaled, and so you will receive your score reports about a month after you take your exam. On your score report, you'll see percentile ranks to see how you scored in comparison to other test takers that took the test at the same exact time, but you will not see your raw score. So you won't see how many questions you got correct or how many questions you missed. You'll only see your scaled score on a scale of 118 to 132, and then your total score. And so a competitive score, if we take a look at the national average, is about 510 to 511. However, every school does have a different competitive score. And so here we have listed some of the scores for the Texas medical schools, with Baylor, Southwestern, Long being between the 516 to 518 range, Dell and McGovern around 512 to 513, and then we have the rest of them as well. And so one important thing I want to talk about this or mention is that everyone, although these are like the competitive scores, it's okay to get above or below the scores. A lot of these admissions councils and panels are going to be looking at your whole application. So the MCAT is one portion of it, as well as all of your other extracurriculars and activities that you've done throughout the years.
Yeah, so I'll talk a little bit now about when to take the MCAT, and we'll also talk about when we individually took the MCAT. So the MCAT is available throughout the year. These are just some of the different months they're available. It's important to note that there are no dates in February or after September. I would also just like to mention here that sometimes it can be hard to get like a seat in a specific MCAT test taking location and the exact location that you want when you want. So if you have a good sense of when you want to take the MCAT, I would definitely start looking at where those spots are early on. I ran into that issue where I had to drive like 3 hours out to take my MCAT. And so just, you know, it's always good to like look early and know where you're headed, because sometimes people do have to end up driving far. So in terms of prerequisites for the MCAT, technically there's none, but there are a lot of recommended classes that we recommend taking before taking the MCAT, just because a lot of the content from these classes ends up being on the MCAT. And so it just makes your job easier when you're studying if you've already been introduced to material through some, you know, class in college. And so this includes general chemistry, organic chemistry, biochemistry, physics, biology, psychology. But I think we'll all kind of touch on this later on, but I think we all kind of had to fill in gaps by ourselves when we were self-studying, but definitely having that baseline knowledge from these classes is super helpful. And in relation to that, a common question that we get is what you should major in. And just like looking at us five, you know, we all majored in different things. And so really there's no right answer here. At the end of the day, it's what you're interested in. And as long as you're completing the prereqs you need for med school anyways, you will, you know, hit on these topics. And then the question about if anatomy is included in the MCAT, anatomy is not. Biological systems of the body are, but anatomy itself is not. So in terms of, again, when should you take the MCAT? This is basically just an overview of us five and when we took the MCAT and how long we studied. And so really the big takeaway from this is that there's a lot of variation in experience. If you look at me and Mehnoor, we studied in a very short period. I studied for 5 weeks, Mehnoor studied for 3 weeks, and alhamdulillah, we were fine. And you know, we were able to get what we needed, and now we're in medical school. And then there's also people that study a little bit longer. So you can see that Salman studied for 6 months, Noreen studied for 3 months, Amina studied for 3.5 months. And so really there's a lot of variation, and it comes down to you just knowing when is the best time for you to study? How do you study? Do you need that longer period, or are you better in a shorter period? And how does that fit into all the other things you're doing as well? Because you're also a college student and you're also balancing a bunch of other things. So just thinking about all of that, and really there's no right way to do it, but it's good to sit down and kind of understand what works best for you.
I think at this point it would be a great idea to go individually and talk about our MCAT studying experience. Just quickly, if you have any pros and cons to what you did, that would be great. So Afifa, do you mind starting off?
Yeah, I can start off. So I basically studied for 5 weeks straight during the winter break of my junior year. And so I started studying end of December, and then I studied all the way up until end of January, which is when I took my MCAT. And I basically treated it as like a 9-to-6, 9-to-5 kind of job every single day for those 5 weeks, which worked out because that was the only thing I was doing for those 5 weeks. But yeah, definitely just took a lot of discipline and a lot of like motivation for me to get up every day and like study every single day. And there were days that it was hard and I didn't want to do it. But alhamdulillah, it worked out. Yeah.
And had you taken all of your, I guess, prerequisite courses or recommended courses beforehand?
I had taken all the recommended classes beforehand, but there were a lot of topics on the MCAT that hadn't been covered in my classes. So there was a lot of self-studying, and we'll talk about Khan Academy and other resources that were really good. So definitely used a lot of those resources to fill in the gaps.
Fantastic. Let's go to Amina next.
Okay, so I studied for about 3.5 months starting after I finished my sophomore year. So I actually took the Princeton course that's offered at UTD. Basically it's like a 1 month long course starting in May and going up, or like starting at the beginning of May to the end of May. And it basically is just like a quick coverage of like the MCAT topics. I just kind of used that. I didn't really seriously study during that time period. I kind of used that as like a framework to see what topics I needed to, you know, get a little bit more background knowledge on before taking practice exams and stuff like that. So that was my framework period. I didn't start studying seriously until that June of my sophomore year summer. And then I studied until September of when I took my exam. And during that time, I would say I spent a lot of time doing practice questions and practice exams. I felt like that was the best way for me to study. Regarding the prerequisites, the only prerequisite that I had not taken during before I took my exam was biochem, and I just self-studied that. The books are, in my opinion, were really they had a lot of good information, and they covered what I needed to know for the exam.
Fantastic. And also, just so everyone's aware, we will be covering more details about the actual resources that we used. This is just a quick overview. Then we'll move on to Salman.
Yeah, so as you guys can see on the screen, I think I'm the only panelist here that took it twice. So the 6 months is a little misleading. I started studying for it the summer after my sophomore year. I also took the Princeton course at UTD. And at the end of the summer, wasn't really happy with where I was. So I was like, I was going to take it again in January. But I hadn't really, I hadn't planned on doing that. So that fall was still kind of busy for me. So I was kind of doing a little bit of light studying every week during that fall semester. And then that winter break was when I kind of just like locked into a cave for about a month and was also doing kind of like a 9-to-5, 9-to-6 every day. Yeah, we'll go a little bit more into the resources that I used there. Was there anything else in particular that we wanted to answer, Noreen?
Did you have any courses that you had self-study or anything like that?
Yeah, so I really recommend taking biochem before you take your MCAT. I took biochem the summer after my sophomore year, and I felt like after I had finished that class, like I had really figured out how to approach a lot of the questions on that biochem section. And this kind of falls into the category of just taking upper level science classes in general, and we'll get a bit more into that later. But I really recommend taking as many prereqs as you can, and if possible, taking biochem before.
Mahnoor? Okay, I think we lost Mahnoor for a little bit, but we'll just circle back. I'll just go ahead and get started. So my study plan was, I guess, similar to Amina's, in which I studied right after my sophomore year. I also took the Princeton class at the same time, but I studied from third-party resources, but a lot more than that. And then I took it right after the beginning of my junior year. At this point, I hadn't taken biochem and I self-studied that, but I agree with Salman that having that background and having that class beforehand would have been helpful, but I don't think it's not doable. I don't think Mahnoor is back yet, but when she comes back, we can definitely circle back.
Cool. And then we also just briefly wanted to talk about the cost that's associated with the MCAT, because the reality of standardized tests and even just a medical education is that it unfortunately comes with a lot of costs. And this is definitely something that Just knowing going in can be really helpful. The MCAT exam itself costs $320. The MCAT study books, things like Kaplan, is something that people use all the time. If you were to buy a new set, that would cost around $200. There's also a lot of practice materials that the AMC provides, and we'll talk more specifically about these, but these are pretty necessary, and these can go anywhere from $150 to $300. And then if you take an MCAT class through things like Princeton or Kaplan or other, you know, companies, that can be 1,000+. And so this does add up really quickly. But if you want to go to the next slide, Noreen, there's a few ways that we can make it more financially feasible. The first thing that is really good to know about is that the AMC actually has a fee assistance program. And if you meet the requirements for this, they actually provide quite a few different things. They'll subsidize the cost of the MCAT to, I think, like $100-something. They actually provide a lot of that AMC practice material free of cost. They also provide support with actually applying to medical schools. They'll cover the cost of your application to, I think, 28 med schools or something like that. And so they have a lot of really great resources. So I would definitely look and see if that is an option that's available to you. For the MCAT books, just ask around and see if people are giving away used books. I actually got my book from a friend that had studied before me, and I was able to pass it down to someone. And so it's kind of just been circulating through our circle. So see if you know anybody that might have books laying around. Similarly with AMC practice materials, I actually shared my subscription with a couple of friends that were also studying, which made it a lot more financially feasible. Classes are generally expensive. So, you know, just think about if that's something that you think will really be beneficial to you. Some people do self-study, some people need classes. And so just kind of think about that as well.
All right. And so just 2 points to make on that. About the MCAT book sharing, that seems like that's actually a very good idea. The MCAT was recently changed in 2015, but the last time that it was changed was in 1991. So the content doesn't really change. How you learn or the tips and tricks that they give also doesn't really change. So using old MCAT books is totally acceptable. And so now we have Mahnoor back. So I'm going to circle back to the MCAT timeline slide. And Mahnoor, if you wouldn't mind sharing your story.
Yes, so sorry, my internet kicked me off, but I'm back. And so as you can see on the chart, I studied my winter break of my senior year. This is when planning becomes really important. So I had kind of just put off MCAT. I wasn't initially planning on taking a gap year, but it was already my senior year and I hadn't taken the MCAT. So this is when I would definitely stress, like, make sure you plan ahead. If you want to take a gap year, then you'll be taking it your senior year. But if you don't want to take a gap year, then you'll be taking your MCAT your junior year. I was working on my thesis at the time. I didn't really have time to study like during the semester. So I just studied over winter break and it ended up being about 3 weeks. And then I just took it that January. To be completely like transparent with you guys, I wasn't super content with my score. So that's why I will say, like, if you're not content, then it's not the end of the world if you have to take it again. I was very stubborn. I was like, I don't want to study again. Like, I'll just like apply as is, but it really isn't the end of the world. Like, alhamdulillah, I got in, but I would say that if you want a competitive application, then go ahead and take it again if you have the time. But that was my story.
I want to I want to add one thing because I did take it twice. And I feel like one consideration you should also make is if you were scoring at like whatever number you had in mind on your practice exams and the real exam comes around and you're, you know, 4 or 5, 6 points below that, then it's fairly obvious at that point that's probably a testing anxiety. And it could just be because it was your first time in a new center. So I would really recommend you take that again and not just settle, even if it is still a good score. But if you're getting around the same score as what you were getting on your practice exams and, you know, you're borderline competitive, you have to ask yourself if taking it again, you would get at least 3 to 4 points higher, because there's nothing wrong with taking it again. But if you're taking it 3 times and you're not improving your score at all, that's when some questions get raised. Like, what were you doing in these extra time that you had? Like, were you not improving? Were you not making any changes to your studying habits? So definitely recommend it if you're not satisfied, but also make sure that you're being realistic with yourself and saying, like, I did better than I was doing on my practice scores, so maybe I shouldn't bother taking it again.
Yeah. Okay. That's a very, very good point, Salman and Mahnoor. And we will circle back to recommended resources.
Awesome. So you're going to hear over the course of the next couple of years, like all sorts of different resources that people are going to be using for the MCAT. And this is by no means an exhaustive list. There's going to be a lot more that come up in the next few years, I'm sure. But these are just some of the ones that we probably all used, or most of us used. So the first two that are highlighted are the AAMC question banks and practice exams. We cannot stress enough how important these are. If you buy nothing else, you should still buy these. These are practice questions and practice exams that are made by the company that writes the MCAT. So you can essentially be sure that this is the style of questions that they're going to throw at you on the actual exam. And they're probably the least expensive resource, say for a couple of the free videos and things like that. But as far as questions are concerned, this is probably the least expensive one as well. And I recommend you set aside about a month or a couple of weeks prior to your exam to like just focus on the AAMC, however long it is. Whenever you start your AAMC questions, you don't look back at any other resource. Like that should be your go-to questions from then on until the exam. For videos, for content review, you can go to Khan Academy. You can also read some books. So the Kaplan books are pretty good. I had the Princeton Review books and they're good, but they're a little bit too in-depth and very thorough sometimes. So you end up pretty much reading textbooks. For the in-person classes, you can take the Princeton Review class or the Kaplan Review. I took the Princeton Review class. I thought it was pretty solid. They have pretty good lecturers who are really smart and have been doing this for dozens of years. So they're able to sort of give you a good introduction to the MCAT and tell you what to expect and which concepts to focus on more, because there's just so much information covered in all those different classes that we talked about before that it's impossible to be a master at all that. So they will tell you like, don't worry about this specific thing. This hasn't been tested in 10 years. And they have really, they have a lot of researchers that are actively looking at previous MCATs and iterations of it and what has been tested as well. So either of those classes are pretty good if you're an in-person learner. For third-party practice questions, I like to swear by UWorld. UWorld was one of the big differences between my first and second attempt at the MCAT. I realized that I learned heavily through practice questions, and all UWorld is just a giant question bank, and you just get to work through questions, and it'll give you a lot of in-depth explanations about what you got right and wrong. And then you also have these blueprint or next step practice exams. So one other thing that we can't stress enough is taking practice exams regularly. A lot of people, they don't like to see the score. They don't like to take an 8-hour exam, understandably. And but I think that it gets you a really good feel for the exam, and you get a much better idea of your strengths and weaknesses if you're taking these regularly and checking in and seeing if you're improving. Next slide, please.
Yeah. Just so we can answer the question that was raised in the chat. Someone asked if the Princeton Review classes are worth it. Salman mentioned a great point about the research that the research and the resources that go behind these classes. That's what you're paying for. Amna and I also took the Princeton courses. Amna, do you want to share your input?
Yeah, so what Salman said, I would emphasize that as well about the Princeton Review courses. One thing for me, what I would say is if you are someone who learns best by self-study, then maybe the Princeton Review classes would not be the best study or the best resource for you. But for me, in my opinion, I knew that I needed at least some kind of framework to get started. I had no idea what the MCAT was about. I didn't know what kind of questions. I didn't know where to start with any of my material. So for me, the Princeton Review was like a great starting point. And then on top of that, the resources that we got from them, the teachers, the question banks, I think the books that we got, although they were dense, they were, in my opinion, they were pretty good. So I really liked the resources that came along with that. And then it was a great starting point for me. And then after that, I also like swore by UWorld. I thought that helped me a lot in addition to the question banks and practice exams. So I would recommend it, but if you're someone who learns best by like self-studying and reading, then maybe you want to weigh your pros and cons.
Yeah, just to piggyback off of that, I learned best by self-studying, and I didn't realize that before I joined the class. And so I mostly studied from Khan Academy to get my actual content, and then used Blueprint, Next Step practice exams to test my knowledge. So personally, I didn't get what I wanted out of that class, but as you just heard, other people do very much so. So again, it depends on your learning style, and we're going to emphasize that later on as well. Afifa and Mahnoor, do you want to add on anything else about any of the resources?
Yeah, I think the biggest thing is, oh, sorry, go ahead, Mahnoor.
You're fine, you're fine.
I was just going to say, yeah, just again, just to reiterate, just understanding yourself. I knew that self-studying was the best for me, so I didn't take any classes. That did mean that I had to do more effort into like researching and putting in some of that extra time into understanding what the MCAT is, because I didn't have someone telling me. But at the end of the day, I think that self-studying worked best for me.
Yeah, I'll touch on this a little bit later as far as like learning styles and knowing like how you learn so that you can best practice in the ways that help you the most. But as far as resources go, I would say Kaplan books, they are very detailed. So I think someone mentioned that it is pretty dense. But so for me, I liked using Exam Crackers because it was a lot more condensed and just like very concise. So because I had less time to study, Exam Crackers, I liked a lot better than Kaplan. Kaplan is really good if you maybe haven't taken a class. Like, for example, I think biochem was big. So if you need to self-study that, I would have used Kaplan instead because it's a lot more in detail. But for me, I liked using Next Step and Exam Crackers because those for me were a lot more concise.
Yeah. All right. We will move on from this.
Okay, so now we're gonna go a bit more specific into each section and see if we can give individualized resources for you guys. So the bio and biochem section is arguably the most important section on the MCAT. That's what's really gonna show your application reader that like this person really not only knows the science in terms of the facts, but is able to interpret and understand scientific passages. So basically what's on it, obviously biology and biochemistry. I pretty much think that you have to take bio before you take this anyway, just by like nature of the pre-med track. But yeah, taking biology, making sure you have a solid foundation is critical to doing well in this section. And probably the biggest reason why a lot of people that are doing well in their science classes that have taken all their prereqs, the reason why they struggle sometimes in this section is because a lot of it is passage-based. And what we mean by that is, they are not necessarily expecting you to just know the information, although there's a lot of that. A lot of it is second and third order questions where they're saying, okay, we're giving you this information. Can you take it a step further and synthesize some new information? So they'll tell you about a new drug and how it works. And then they'll ask you, you know, if this drug is given to this patient, what will happen? Or is given to this rat, what will happen? Or they'll give you some data and graphics to analyze. So it's a lot about being able to read and decipher scientific articles. And that's where I think taking the upper level classes, doing research, things like that, that are really making, really challenging your mind and making you think, those are really gonna come into play here. And it doesn't necessarily even have to be strictly biology level or biology upper level classes, just upper level classes in general science fields that are requiring that you're synthesizing new information will be very, very helpful. And practice questions always are gonna be great. So I used UWorld for that one. And I thought it was very helpful. And then of course, the AAMC question banks for practice questions are really good. As far as content, I think for the free resources, you have Khan Academy. Everybody knows who Khan Academy is, but Ninja Nerd is also a one that is used a lot in medical school. And he has some great videos on YouTube and they're all free as well. And then for books, I think Kaplan does a great job of covering the biology section. I use the Princeton biology book and it's super dense, super thorough. It's not necessary to be that dense, but I thought it was pretty good. And then the Princeton biochem book is pretty thorough, but it's not nearly as dense as the bio section is. So all those books are pretty great. The good thing about the biochem section is you can get the content from just about anywhere. It's pretty standardized. So what's really important here is just, like I said, building that foundation and being able to understand the articles and doing a lot of practice questions. So for Chem Phys, this is one thing that's a little harder to move up and down your score, just because a lot of it requires some base level problem solving skills. So there's general chemistry, organic chemistry, biochemistry, and physics, and they're all pretty evenly distributed throughout. I would say if there was one that's less, I think it's organic chemistry. They advertise all of the percentages on, I think, any of the Princeton resources, or maybe even the AAMC will advertise it too. But it's a pretty even split. So you have to have a good bit of base knowledge on all of them. One thing that I found was really helpful was creating an equations cheat sheet. And what I mean by that is they do actually expect you to memorize and be able to interpret a good bit of equations, specifically on the physics section, but also a little bit on the general chemistry section. So I didn't spend a whole lot of time specifically learning physics, but I did do a good bit of practice questions. And so I would write down which equations they were expecting me to know. And over time, I was able to see a pattern. Like pretty much there's about, you know, 5 to 10, maybe max 15 equations that they were really expecting me to come in to the exam knowing. So I would write those down and I would create my own cheat sheet for general chemistry and physics. Biochem and organic chem, there's some pretty general formulas you might need to know, but for the most part, I think it's more just reasoning. For content for ChemPhys, I thought Khan Academy does a great job. The Kaplan and Princeton books are also really thorough and in-depth. And then lastly, practice questions. Like I said, I can't stress this enough. I really liked UWorld. I think they do a great job of walking you through the question if you get it wrong and giving great explanations there. And then the AMC ChemPhys question bank and section banks are really, really helpful. And for those of you guys that probably it's your first time hearing this, so the Q banks are these light, like 120 question like packs from the AMC. And the they're usually a little bit easier. They're just there to kind of get you to learn your content really well. Section banks are much tougher. I would say they're a little bit tougher than the actual exam. And they're there more to build on like your test taking strategies, less about content, more about like actual strategy itself. But both are very, very useful.
Yes, and there was a question in the chat wondering about if Kaplan is more or less in depth for biology than the Princeton textbook. Someone, do you want to answer that?
I think Princeton is definitely more in depth. I think Kaplan covers pretty much all that you need as well. I think Princeton structures there is more like a textbook. So they ensure that there's almost nothing that the MCAT can throw at you that the Princeton book doesn't have. But I think both are really solid. Kaplan's definitely a little bit easier to read through though. Okay, and then on the psych-soc section, this is probably the one that I study the least for. And I'll tell you, it's not terrible. There's just a lot of memorization on there. So so what's on it is psychology and sociology. This is probably the one section where you really don't need any classes in advance. Well, that and reading, I guess, but you don't need to take any classes in advance of this. Taking a psych or a social class would help, but certainly not necessary. I think one of our panelists said that they just relied on the AP class that they took in high school and that knowledge carried over enough. And that's true. I think a lot of it is memorizing some of the content and the terminology. And for that, I really recommend the Khan Academy cheat sheets. So the cheat sheets are basically just the Khan Academy videos, but like their transcript just printed out. And there's an 86-page version and a 300-page version. I printed the 86-page version out. I printed it so I could stop like my eye strain from staring at the screen all day, which is another underrated aspect of this. Like you'll be hurting your eyes if you're studying on your screen all day. So I printed these sheets out and I would literally look at this every day for like the week leading up to the exam. I don't recommend cramming like that, but I do think that if you go through that like bit by bit throughout your studying process, I think it's really good and it's a good way to keep all that content. Like I said, a lot of vocab and terminology, using flashcards for like active recall is really good. And for videos, Khan Academy does a great job of explaining it. You can speed through all of them in probably like a day if you really wanted to just sit down and do that. And then for practice questions, there's just an AMC section bank. That does a pretty good job. And the UWorld also has a good bit of psych questions, but I think that you don't have to do as many practice questions for those just because it's a lot more content-based than problem solving. And last is the reading section. This was probably my least favorite because there's not like an objective like set of information or content you can focus on to improve your score. This one literally just comes with time and practice. And I think like a huge emphasis here is time. It's not so much about how many passages you're doing. I think probably the ideal way is to just do a couple of passages every other day or every day, and really no more than like two or three a day is fine. And unless you're taking a practice exam, we're trying to stimulate that. But the idea is you do them timed. I actually recommend you give yourself more time when you're starting out and focus more on getting that quality. And it's because it's easier to speed up once you know how to do it than it is to like just be really fast early on and then try and get a little bit like more accurate each time. So for the books, I thought the Princeton Cars workbook, I didn't use it personally. I just used the, I used some of the Princeton's, but Princeton also gives you like online, like questions you can work through in passages. I used some of those. And then I did use a friend's exam crackers workbook, but again, not a whole lot. Jack Weinstein is pretty solid. I've heard that from a lot of people. And then I used a good bit of UWorld and the AAMC question packs. Those are all really, really solid resources. But yeah, I think the key for this is don't just try and power through and do a whole bunch at once. Slow and steady wins the race in CARS, and it really builds that ability to understand the articles. We have some questions in the chat, or okay. Oh. Do we want to answer the questions in the chat, or do you want to go through this slide, Noreen?
I'll be answering the questions in the chat, but I will be looping back to them later on.
Okay, so I think this is my last slide. So, yeah. One thing I really want to emphasize is like, I know that I just gave you guys a whole bunch of information. This is, resource overload is probably one of the most like commonly encountered issues on the MCAT and in med school. So if you're watching this and you're still in high school, like you should not be worrying about the MCAT. You're already 10 steps ahead of at least where I was when I was in high school. So please don't stress about this right now. The objective of this is to at least get it so that way when the time comes, some of this will come back to you and like you'll remember at least a couple of pieces of our advice here and there. If you're early in college and looking to take the MCAT in the next couple of years, again, don't freak out. I honestly, ideally, you'll pick like two or three resources that really work for you and you'll just like, you'll go through those and those will be fine. Those will be enough for you. The content is not changing regardless of which resource you choose to take it from. The good thing about science is that it's fairly standardized. So I wouldn't stress about it. The only thing that you really need to worry about in this moment, if you're like first or second year in college, is like do well in your classes, right? The MCAT doesn't matter if you're not like doing well in classes. I think focus on what's in front of you. And when the time comes to plan out for your MCAT, you'll be able to do that because you've already had a solid foundation. So, and the last point I want to touch on is that there's so many different study habits and learning styles. I'm not somebody who can plan out 3 months of studying. I know somebody that would rather spend 3 days away from studying and just plan for the next couple of months. I'm a doer. So I will literally take it one day at a time, 1 week at a time and say like, here's a list of things that I want to get through this week. And I'll break it down, each day, how much do I think I can handle today? And there's going to be days where you just like can't do much at all and you have to take some time off or take a light day. And then other days where you feel like you can just go for 12 hours straight. So it's all about like listening to yourself and knowing how you operate and using the resources that best align with that. And so you definitely do not have to use all these to be successful. We do recommend the AAMC resources as probably, if you're gonna use anything, those are the ones you should use. But all the other ones, we know they can add up to a lot of money. So the other ones are not, it's not that crucial that you use every single one of those at all.
Yeah, and just before we move on to kind of the final end of the presentation, I wanted to emphasize the fact that this presentation has a lot of sampling bias, just because a lot of us are very traditional students. But just because we only took 4 years to get through undergrad doesn't mean that other people, that doesn't discount the fact that other people took longer or shorter. Just because most of us didn't take gap years, that doesn't disqualify anyone from people like from going to med school if you've taken 1, 5, 10, you have a second career and then going to med school. So we just wanted to emphasize that this stuff that we have presented here is not set in stone. Like that last point says, you don't have to use all these resources. You may not even use any of these resources. You might find something else that works better for you. And so we just wanted to emphasize that before we move on. Okay.
All right. So I did want to just touch on something Salman said. He mentioned that he's a doer and that sometimes you don't. So that's something that I struggled with, is I was like looking for all the best ways to study and I was just like trying to prepare myself. I think the best thing with, like, as we keep mentioning, this is a lot of information for you guys. And so I think the best thing you can do is just get started, just start somewhere. Like, you don't have to, like, you learn along the way what works for you, what doesn't, what materials kind of align with your study, like how you study best. So I think the best thing is to just get started. So the main thing is you want to do as many practice questions as possible. And so you also want to take as many practice exams as possible. So the biggest thing with the MCAT is that it's very long, it's very boring. So you have to make sure that you're used to testing in the same condition that you will be testing on test day. So simulate real testing conditions, like I forgot the exact breakdown, but I believe you have like one big snack break after two sections. So like treat it the same way that you would on test day, like sit down in the same spot and just take the exam for however many hours that it takes. Like don't go and like talk and like chill with your family members in between, or like, you know, split the day in half, like just spend a day. I would use weekends. So I would do like every Saturday, I would take a practice exam. And just like do it the way that you would properly do it, because most of the MCAT is just like learning how to take the exam. It's not necessarily just all about content. So along with practice exams, I think the most important thing is practice questions more so than content. Once you take your exam, going through the practice questions and figuring out why you missed what you missed, looking at the things you know. I didn't do this, but one of my friends, she had a huge Excel document where she put the questions that she missed and then why she missed it, like what she needed to know. And the things that she got right, she just didn't pay attention to those because she already knew them. So just focusing on the things that you got wrong and having like a big spreadsheet, if that's what helps you, just to see like what things you need to focus on. The most important materials will be your AMC materials, because that's from the actual test taker, the test maker. But I would save those for the end. I mean, not too close to time, because you do want time to go through them, but I think those will be most indicative of how the exam questions will be. So go ahead and use up all the other Princeton review, like Kaplan, exam crackers, all those other exam tests first. If you go on the AMC website, I think they have like different packages that you can buy. I would buy those. Maybe take at least one. I think there's a couple that they give you. Maybe take at least one early on, just so that you know how different it is from the other resources, because there are some resources that I, in my opinion, didn't like the tests, the practice tests that they give you didn't really align with how AMC tests you. So I would say save most of those materials for like closer to time, but do take one practice exam early on so you know like what to look for, how they test you and stuff. I think someone asked about study plans earlier in the chat. So if you are doing self-study, so I did self-study, there are a couple of study plans. Exam Crackers has an 8 to 10 week schedule, and they like break it down for you. Like on Monday, you're going to do this passage, you're going to do this, you're going to do these questions. So it's very, I thought it was a really good schedule, especially if you're self-studying. I think there are a couple of others. I think Kaplan does a self-study schedule too. If you just look it up, I'm sure you'll find plenty. But yeah, so there are a lot of self-study schedules. Choose one that works for you, and you can always amend it based on whatever else you have going on in your life. But I will say things that we touched on earlier, like knowing your study style. I'll talk about that in a little bit, but like if you know that you need a little bit more discipline, like that you're not as good about keeping to a plan by yourself, then I would maybe look into taking a class or like having a study partner or some sort of accountability partner, so that you make sure that you are sticking to a schedule. Because I think that was the biggest thing for me, is that unless like you for MCAT, you have to treat it like a full-time job, similar to when you're in medical school, you have to treat studying like a full-time job. Otherwise, like it's really easy to get behind and not like, there's so much information that you need to like be very disciplined about it. So I would definitely say like stick to a plan. If you kind of stray from it a little bit, that's okay, but try to stick to it as much as you can. And of course, take care of yourself. Like if there's a week where you're just like, I can't look at anything anymore, like it's not going to be useful to you if you still study and you just like really need a break. So just take a break so that whenever you have rested and you're back like better mentally, like you can properly study and do it right. Okay, yeah. So I touched on this a little bit, knowing your study style. If you know that you're not maybe as disciplined as your friends, or like you need some sort of structure or framework. I think Amina mentioned that she took the class because she needed like a framework. Like look into taking a class if like cost isn't too big of an issue, and there are like financing programs that can help you with that as well. Or like, even if you do want to self-study, like I would recommend like doing it with a friend, or like having some sort of accountability partner that tells you like that you guys check up on each other and like, okay, like what passages have you finished today? Or like what, how many practice exam questions did you do today? Cause I think if it's just you, it's easy to just be like, oh, like it's so boring. Like, I don't like this. Like, I don't want to do this anymore. Like having someone there with you, studying with you helps a lot. Especially for me, like, I wish I had my friends like hold me accountable. Practice exams is the biggest thing. That like, do so many practice questions. Like, even if you feel like you don't know the content, doesn't matter. Just jump straight into the practice questions. You will learn through like getting questions wrong. You will learn the content through getting questions wrong and like seeing what, how they test it to you. And like I said earlier, don't feel like, if you do bad the first time, like you're done for, like you can't get into medical school. You can always take it again and it won't be the end of the world. And you'll know what to expect. Like someone said, like if you have test taking anxiety, like sometimes it's not that you didn't know the information or that you weren't prepared. It's just because it's a huge exam and it's scary, and it can help if you're test taking anxiety, if you need to take it again. And like I said, finding a supportive community, like reaching out to advisors, reaching out to people, asking them for advice. That being said, like don't get overwhelmed because everybody's gonna tell you something different. Do what works for you. Like even if someone's like, oh, like do this, like it's gonna help you get a 528, like it'll be perfect. Like if that strategy doesn't work for you, then don't worry about it. Like you do what works for you, because everyone's study strategies are different and everyone learns differently. So don't get overwhelmed with the plethora of advice that's being thrown at you. Okay, so for test taking tips, I think it's really important to make sure that the night before you're in a good headspace. So my test taking site was about 30 minutes away, and I lived in a dorm, so I knew that like, and I was an RA in college, so I knew that like my residents could be like coming up to my door like in the middle of the night, or there'd be people running in the hallways. So I actually got a hotel the night before, like close to my testing site, and I stayed at a hotel the night before so that I wouldn't have to worry about any crazy things happening in the dorm the night before. And I made sure that I got a good night's sleep and I was close to the test taking site. So I wouldn't have to worry about traffic or anything in the morning. So that's like one less thing to worry about in the morning. So whatever you can do to properly prepare and like make sure that you don't have to worry about being anxious in the morning can help you a lot, like with your mind state, your headspace in the morning. So pack a good lunch, pack good snacks. I have a little bit of a funny story. For my snack, I had Cheez-Its, and I don't know, I was so nervous that I like accidentally swallowed a Cheez-It whole and I started choking on a Cheez-It in the middle of my break. So I would say like use snacks that you can't choke on, like something light, something that's not like, it was something so stupid. I was like, I cannot believe I'm going to like choke on something in the middle of my MCAT, die because I'm in the middle of my MCAT. I was like, I'm not doing this right now. So definitely choose your snacks. Maybe I have a banana or something soft. I don't know. This is something very rare, so it just happened to me. But yeah, have lots of water. Make sure that you have whenever you do take your break, like take a proper break, because just like have your snack, like enjoy it, because you're going to go back and then it's a long day. So wear comfortable clothes. And I definitely agree with the scheduling something fun after. I remember afterwards, I was so tired. I was just like, I'm sick of this. Like, I just want to do something fun. So my friends and we like went out and like did karaoke or something that day. So have something to look forward to. Like, even if like just plan it in advance, like ask your friends, like, hey, like I'm taking my MCAT on this day. Like, I'd love to do something fun afterwards. So I have something to look forward to. Having those things to look forward to makes it go a lot smoother and like a lot easier, because you're like, okay, I just need to get through this. I can do this. And then like, I'm free, hopefully. So yeah, inshallah. And of course, like make sure to read your du'as and like, just put your trust in Allah, like plan it and prepare as much as you can, and then leave the rest to Him, and inshallah, it'll go okay. Yeah.
Like Salman mentioned, he actually skydived the next day. So that was his fun activity. All right. So that was the end of our presentation. We have 45 minutes for questions, answers. And to begin with, Amira posted in the chat, was your studying experience similar for the MCAT, similar to the one for your SAT? I know it's been a while, but it would be helpful if you could share. Anyone wants to take that question?
Yeah, I think the biggest difference between the MCAT and the SAT is that the MCAT has more like content on it, stuff that you actually have to sit down and learn and memorize, whereas the SAT is, I think, a little bit more reliant on test taking strategies and things like that. And so the biggest thing with the MCAT and preparing for it is actually setting time aside to learn that content, review that content, make sure you know that content.
Does anyone have anything else to add on? Yeah, I would echo everything that Afifa said. It's basically 4 years of education that they're testing you on. And so, you know, you just have to stick to a study plan and try and get through it. Someone asked thoughts about Anki.
Yeah, so Anki is something that is really widely used in med school. I don't think it's necessary for the MCAT. There are some aspects of it that I think are really, really great for the MCAT. For example, like the content that you need for psych. I didn't personally use it at all in the MCAT, but I know that a lot of people would use it for psych and a couple of like those nitty gritty facts that you just kind of had to know, like random amino acids and, you know, OChem formulas. So if you're someone that works well with Anki, if you've used it before, I highly recommend sticking with it. But if you don't use it, like, don't worry about trying to pick up a new software and trying to see if, you know, that'll be the thing that gets you over the hump, because if the idea about studying for the MCAT is you want to be comfortable when you're studying, and trying to figure out like how best to use a completely new way of learning is going to seriously cut into your studying time.
Yeah. We have another question. If you took the MCAT in your senior year, do you have to take a gap year? I think Mahnoor, you'd be best to answer this one.
Yeah. So if there are places, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think there are places that can take a MCAT score after you apply. But if you take the MCAT your senior year, you will be applying the following summer because you do need your MCAT score to be able to apply to places. I think there might be, I mean, that may be something you might want to look into. There might be some places that can take a delayed MCAT score, but it wouldn't be too delayed. So you would still have to apply the summer after your junior year if you didn't want to take a gap year. And then maybe if you took your MCAT that August or something, like very early on in senior year, then you could send your score to those schools later after you already applied. But if you haven't applied and you need to take your MCAT before, then you will have to take a gap year if you're taking it later on in your senior year.
Just to piggyback off of that, COVID has changed a lot of the medical school admissions process. So they also changed the MCAT during this time. So they would have 3 testing times instead of 1 on certain dates. But obviously with COVID, everything is changing and shifting around. So I know at least during our cycle, or mine, FIFA and Omna cycle, they were allowing students to submit their actual application. And then when they would get their MCAT score, that'd be added on to the application process. The thing to note is that a lot of med schools will not look at your application until everything is complete. So that's like a whole nother topic. But basically your application includes like the actual application, essays, MCAT scores, certain like aptitude tests, if you're especially in Texas, and secondary applications, which are school specific. And so because of this, that's why it takes so long for us to apply to medical school. And then you have to do interviews on top of that. So just that whole process does play into the timeline of applying to medical school, going to medical school. But I think we're gonna be hosting another workshop on the actual application to medical school. But yeah, okay. Next question is, when studying for the MCAT during a school semester, how do you balance classes and MCAT studying? I think Salman, you'd be great for this.
Yeah, I touched on this a little bit in my comment, but first thing is that school comes first, right? So if studying for the MCAT is going to cause you to have a C in a class, then it's not worth it. So first, make sure you're getting that taken care of. And then schedule some time in there on the weekends between classes to do some practice questions here and there. I was still taking classes that semester because I didn't think that I was going to have to be studying for it during the fall, but I still had a fairly lighter load than I would have had during normal years. So that's kind of important, is that if you're planning on taking it in January, or if it's even a possibility that you'll be taking it in January, then make sure that fall semester is light enough that you're still able to squeeze, you know, 5, maybe if you're lucky, 10 hours a week into just doing practice questions and getting some content review in there. I think that if you are someone that uses Anki or flashcards, it's a much more streamlined process. You don't have to think about how you're going to study. You can just do some flashcards in between classes or things like that, or do some UWorld questions. If you're not, though, you know, just cracking open your book and reading a chapter every other day, going through like 3 chapters a week, something like that, just giving yourself less strict guidelines to follow, but still trying to meet a certain benchmark of, I want to get through this many chapters, this many questions, whatever. So that way you're not losing any material. That's probably the most important thing, is you don't want to regress during that time. And then you want to maximize those weekends and those breaks that you have in between classes.
Yeah, so just to quickly wrap up for Salman, he has to leave in a few minutes, but this is all of our contact information. And Salman, before you leave, do you want to give one piece of important advice?
I think you guys have all said pretty much everything that I had to say. You know, don't stress about it. This is it's a marathon, not a sprint. There's a million things to stress about that'll come later. And, you know, if you keep telling, and we all have gone through this now, like, oh, I'll be happy after the MCAT. I'll be happy after I apply. I'll be happy after step one. And right now I'm at that step one phase. And I'm going to try really hard not to delude myself into thinking that my happiness will come after. And just enjoy the journey. MCAT is a really, really, really tough time. It's a lot to study, but you don't have to be miserable. A lot of people think that they can't talk to anybody during that time. They can't be with family. And that's not true. I think setting reasonable boundaries for yourself, saying that at 6 o'clock, like, the information will be there tomorrow, I can study this tomorrow. You know, some days you're just not having a good study day. It's better to just give yourself that time off. So, you know, don't stress about it too much. You will be fine. Everybody has had to take this at some point or another. It's been going down this route. So give yourself some slack. You're naturally, like, you're probably your own hardest critic. So you guys will be fine.
Yeah. All right. Thank you so much, Salman.
Take care, guys.
Okay. And then we have a few other questions. If our study plan is over the course of a couple of months, how many months out should we start using resources such as UWorld and NextStep? I think Amina, you could answer this one.
Yes. So I used UWorld a lot. I took my MCAT in mid-September, September 13th to be exact. So I started 2 months before that, I started using UWorld. And then 1 month before my exam date, I started using all the AMC question banks and all those things. I know people who have used UWorld like throughout their whole duration of studying. What I personally did was I started studying in June. So June to mid-July, I would use the Princeton resources that they had. So I would use the Princeton books in addition to the Princeton practice material. Mid-July to my exam date, I would use UWorld questions. I went through UWorld fairly quickly just because their practice questions, they have really good explanations for why certain answer choices are right, why certain answer choices are wrong. So I paced myself for about like 4 to 5 weeks, I did UWorld. And then the month before my exam, I solely focused on AMC question material. So that's how I used my UWorld for myself. I did not use NextStep though. But I know that's a really good resource as well.
Yeah, so I did use NextStep. And so just like Amna said, I blocked off that last month before my MCAT, which was the end of August. Starting from August, I only used AAMC material. I started studying in June. So from June to July I didn't do any practice questions during this time, but I only use Khan Academy mainly to do my content review. And then July to August, I did blueprint exams, which is also called NextStep. So I did practice exams from that and then Princeton practice exams as well. And so, yeah, very you know, it just depends on your learning style and how you think that you can use your resources. Not too quickly, obviously, because then you're going to be out of them, but, you know, spreading them out well. And then question is MCAT versus step one, which is harder? Mahnoor, you'd be best to answer this one.
So I have not really begun step one studying yet. That'll be the second I come back. I'm just taking a break. We're in winter break right now. And then the spring semester is usually when people buckle down and start studying for step your second year. I would say, I think by the time you're in medical school, by the time you've reached your second year, you know how to study better. So for me, I think step one studying will be a little bit easier because I know what to expect. I know how much work goes into it. I know like what resources I work best with. Like I know that Boards and Beyond, Pathoma, and Sketchy are like my top three for future reference whenever you guys get into medical school, inshallah. Like those are really good resources to use in medical school. So I wouldn't say it's not necessarily a question of which one is harder. I think you're just better equipped, like more prepared and like wiser when it comes to step two. And so inshallah that it becomes easier for you to know how to, I guess, approach it. Yeah.
Yeah, just to echo off of that, just in my first semester of med school, I realized how important it is to know yourself and your learning style. So if you're able to discover that even during MCAT, that'll help you out tremendously while you're, you know, going through the first semester of medical school. Does anyone else have any questions? Yasmin, you asked if we have the link to the Khan Academy cheat sheets. I believe if you just Google them, I think people on Reddit usually have links to them. Student Doctor Network is another website that a lot of people that are applying to med school use. I would recommend not taking everything on Student Doctor Network as fact, just because, like, you know, there's a lot of people, again, like how we said, a lot of people have different ways of studying. And so just because someone says that they did this method to get a 528 doesn't necessarily mean that you need to do that. So yeah, just take everything that you read online with and what people tell you really with a grain of salt, and get as many opinions as you can, especially if you're just starting out, just trying to find your way in this process. Yeah. Okay, I don't think there's any more questions. So Amna, just going down the line, can you give us one piece of advice that you wish you could have given your younger self?
Yes, I would definitely say to trust yourself. I think all of us have done a good, have done really well on emphasizing that during this session. One thing I would tell myself is like, when I was studying, I was always like questioning whether I was doing the right thing, whether my scores were actually reflective of what I knew, all those things. And, you know, once I took my MCAT, got my scores back, and alhamdulillah, I'm now in medical school, like, it's validating now that I look back at it, right? But I wish I could tell myself to trust myself, trust the process, that, you know, when things don't work out for you, or things are not working in the way that you want them to, that it's okay to step back and, you know, reflect and like, make adjustments from there. So biggest thing I would say is trust yourself, trust your gut, and just, you know, everyone is different. So if things work for you, that doesn't work for someone else, that's completely okay. And I think that's the mindset I have in medical school as well. You know, there's so much material that you learn. It's important to take care of yourself and to realize, you know, at what point do you need to take a break? At what point do you need to just like take a break and just like step back and adjust? So that's what I would say.
Awesome. Afifa?
Yeah, I think similar lines. Just know that it's not impossible. I think when you're studying for it, it feels like it's impossible. And you tend to compare yourself to how other people are studying. And you tell yourself, you know, like, I'm not doing enough, or I didn't start enough early enough. And just remember that regardless of where you are, like, you can reach to a point that you want to reach, and it's totally doable with the right amount of discipline and the right amount of kindness, because both of those things are necessary. And yeah, it's definitely doable.
Noor?
Yeah, I think everyone has great, great comments, great advice. I think like the biggest thing, like everyone keeps saying, like it's a marathon, not a sprint. Like, just go easy on yourself. And I will say, like, So I guess most pre-meds you meet are very type A. And so like, they're very on top of it. In my case, I was a lot more relaxed, more than I should have been. So I will say, like, even if you are really busy in school and like, you like feel like you don't have time to study for MCAT, like just take a little bit of time, like here and there. Like if you're taking it in the middle of the semester, then like, just like set aside like 2 hours a day to just look at MCAT stuff. Like don't push it off too much because, and at the same time, like, don't make it your entire like world. So having a good balance, I think, is the most important thing when you're studying. Have a balance with like studying and like your social life and your school life and everything else, because the biggest thing about MCAT is that it kind of prepares you on how to study, because learning how to study and how to be motivated, how to be disciplined is a vital skill in medical school. Like in medical school, you're going to run into the same issue of like needing to balance like how much to study and how much to like have a life outside of medical school, which is super important too. So I think the biggest thing is just like finding that balance, and don't get too overwhelmed. Don't be too hard on yourself. It's all a learning process. And inshallah, throughout your journey, you're going to learn how to do better and like what works for you and what doesn't. So don't get too overwhelmed with all the external resources and all the advice being thrown at you. But yeah.
Yeah. And so just to wrap up, I wanted to shout out another special member of this whole workshop. It's Manal Ahmed. She's been really active in the chat. She's an MS2 at Southwestern as well. And she is a non-traditional student. So if you have any questions specifically about non-traditional, gap years, things like that, feel free to shoot her an email. She's put it in the chat. And also she is the coordinator head of the AMWPA mentorship program, which is what this whole workshop is a part of. And so I'll include the WhatsApp link in the chat as well, just so in case anyone wants to follow and get some more advice, connections, you know, networking, things like that. And then to wrap up, this is our contact info. Feel free to shoot us an email. You can email one of us, all of us. It's totally fine. We're more than willing to help. So yeah, thank you everyone for your time, and we hope you found this beneficial.